Good evening. Thank you and welcome here. I'm really happy that all of you have been able to make it. I must admit that I expected much huger numbers and I thought that we would be spilling out onto the road, so maybe there are some more people on their way here. Before I start, I would like to invite my co-panelists, the Write India authors who are here with us today. Ashwin Sanghi, Ravi Subramanian, Ashwin, who juggles between business and writing and has churned out successful thrillers ranging from theological to business with a historical twist. Ashwin Sanghi. Ravi Subramanian, the banker who stayed a banker and wrote banking thrillers till the love bug hit him, and now he's brought out a romance. May I also invite on stage Tuhin Sinha, Tuhin, who I must say has maintained a bit of a more low profile than he should really, and has written several books which have done exceedingly well, and has tried his hand at a different kinds of news in all his books. Durjoy Datta, from book writing to TV writing, Durjoy Datta is the author of 12 best-selling novels targeting the youth of India, and I have seen how they target him rather than he targeting them. We were in Kolkata recently, and I think I, rather than introducing and launching his book, I had to play more the role of saving him from all the Kolkata bomb duties there. May I invite on stage our lovely lady Madhuri Banerjee. I'm doing a reverse. Normally it's ladies first. I'm inviting the lady last. We have another chair, yes. So Madhuri is a world traveler, an avid reader, a coffee addict, an amateur photographer, an Instagram addict, and a doting mother. And she says she is also a philosopher at heart. The other day she came to our office in Delhi and started predicting future for most of my teammates. And they were all like, you know, really fascinated by that. So we have here our team. As you know, we have a total of 11 Write India authors. Some of them are not here. Amisha is expected in a short while. Chetan Bhagat and Ravinder Singh, Anita, Jayashree Mishra. They are not in the city. So that makes up a total of 11 authors. And Write India, as you've been told, is an initiative which we started to nudge out the writer in all of you. Writing is something that is actually, when you start off, it's a scary activity because you feel inhibited and you feel that maybe you will not be able to write. And yet everybody wants to write. Everybody wants to write because everybody has a story to tell. And you want to tell your stories, your experiences in your own way. You have a view to share. And the more we are exposed to globalization, the more we are educated, we become more and more secure and confident of ourselves, and we wish to express ourselves better. So you find many, many more people today who want to write than they used to be some years ago. And storytelling is a great way of connecting with each other. So there is nothing, no pleasure better than knowing that we are all ultimately connected to each other. We are not alone in this world. Despite different cultural and sociological differences, differences of gender, differences of social stature, deep down there is that deep connect within all of us. We share the same emotions, we share the same thoughts. And the best way to show that connectedness is through storytelling, which is what we try to bring out from all of you. Storytelling is a great communication tool. You are able to put across thoughts that you would not be able to put without the help of a story. And certainly the brain can absorb stories much better than facts and figures. Facts and figures stick to the brain when there's a story around them. For instance, if I were to tell you that, say, 15 plus age group of girls wrote for, say, Chetan Bhagat. I'm just using, let's say Durjoy. Yes. Okay, so, but that's more easily relatable. That's why I didn't use that in particular, because if I say Chetan 15 plus, you're not able to relate so well to that. So you will not, you may not remember, but if I were to tell you a story behind it, that they wrote because Chetan's story talked about a blue silk scarf or something. So the story is something that sticks the facts to your mind. So we are all here. I have with me great storytellers. You know them all. I don't want to keep them from you. I want them to tell you more about Write India, more about themselves, their writing styles. And we want you to ask the questions. So I'm going to start with Ashwin Sanghi. The first time I... Yes. The first time I saw Ashwin, I met Ashwin, he was on stage and I was part of the audience. And in his usual very generous style, he was giving such interesting writing tips to people there. And the sincerity was like, you know, quite palpable. So we went back home and my son was with me. And when we went back home, my son started telling me that, did you know this? Did you know that? So it was something that really struck me. And I want you to share some of that with the audience here, Ashwin. Your style of writing, how do you write?
Okay. Thank you, Vinita. Now you've set the expectation bar so high that it's going to be a difficult act to follow. I don't know. I've never thought of myself really as a writer. It's much more about storytelling. And I don't think you need to be a great writer in order to be a good storyteller. I think the way I like to think about it, you know, it was the wonderful Alfred Hitchcock who said that a great movie, the length of a great movie, will always be related to the capacity of the human bladder. So how long a movie is depends upon how much you can sustain in terms of your capacity. And the way I like to think about it when I'm writing a book is that there is a circle of friends sitting around me and I'm telling them a story, and I'm telling them that story in such a way that they don't want to get up. And they don't even want to get up in case they need to go and pee. Now, if you can achieve that, then I think you have a great story on hand. So that's precisely where I'm coming from. Then after that, it's the job of the editors and the guys who need to make sure that you've used the right words and the right punctuation, and all of that can come later. But ultimately, either you can tell a good story or you can't. And if you can tell that great story, then the rest of it really doesn't matter.
Thank you. So, you know, a lot of us, we think that that writing is a very difficult task. Writing is something that you're not either born with or not born with. You can learn writing. But what is a great art is the art of storytelling. It's the art of observation, of being able to look at things with a different skew from the rest of the world, and possibly being able to laugh at the world and to be able to laugh at yourself. If you can do all that, you are great storytellers. You know, when I'll come to some very interesting stats from Write India. We have about 18,000 stories in now. In fact, more than that, 18,000 and counting, because we haven't counted the last author. And this has been a real, I won't say a shock, but a very pleasant surprise for us, because when we started off, we didn't really know what would happen, whether we would get enough people to write. But it's amazing the kind of response that we've got. And out of the stats that I will bring to you, one very interesting one has been that Delhi wrote, most of the people who wrote for Ravi Subramanyam were Delhiites. Most of the homemakers who wrote for Ravi Subramanyam. When we looked at the number of people, the men and the women, when we looked at the gender divide, it was mostly men writing for Ravi Subramanyam. Why? The topic was infidelity. Delhi, homemakers, men. Ravi, tell us now, what made you switch from banking to infidelity?
I just figured out that most of the Delhi women were not reading my books. So I decided to write about romance and infidelity. Now, on a serious note, you know, Ashwin, I completely agree with you that it's all about storytelling. And you typically have a good editor, the writing bit is taken care of. But storytelling is something which comes from within, and when you read a good book, you invariably enjoy the story, okay? And the story stays with you longer than the writing. And I think that's something which is a point very well made, Ashwin. And to your point, Vinita, well, I was getting a bit bored of writing banking thrillers. And I said, how is it that when I look at book launches by Durjoy Dutta, you know, you have all those young women hanging from the roofs, you know, ceiling, holding on and jumping onto him and screaming and shouting. You saw that in Calcutta, right? And when I yeah, but having said that, I think I believe that a good story. This is being recorded, right? Okay, so I have to say the right things now. Okay, on a serious note, I believe that any author who kind of boxes himself into a genre is not doing justice to his craft. If you are a good storyteller, while you might start telling a story in a genre that you are comfortable with, you might start writing about things you know, okay? But unless you experiment, unless you try and write something different, write something new, you will never evolve. And I think that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to challenge myself. I had always written plot-driven stories. All my books, which are racy thrillers, are all plot-driven. There is, you know, a character comes in and goes out like this. So, to me, character development in my previous books was never a priority. But then I started looking at my writing style. Let me challenge myself and see if I can write a character-driven and yet racy story, which has to be a romance, because a romance is extremely character-driven. You have to take time and effort and build that character without sounding boring. And these guys, Madhuri, Durjoy, Tuhin, do that fabulously. So I thought, let me at least try what they do. And that's the reason why I wrote the bestseller she wrote, which is a romance. There are elements of thriller which have crept into it. That's probably because of who I am and the way I write. But yeah, I think for a first effort at romance, it's a reasonably good effort. And I'm proud of it. Kind of romance. Okay. It depends on the kind of romance. But yeah, so that's the reason why I wrote. To challenge myself and also to reach out to a much wider audience. Because thrillers has a limited audience in this country and largely a male audience. Many women here do read thrillers, but by and large, thrillers are read by men. A large airport population reads thrillers. So I wanted to reach out to a completely different segment and see if I can write a story which appeals to them. And that's the reason why I wrote about romance.
So this is something which is completely different about this generation of writers, that they don't just write for themselves, sitting in their ivory towers. They write for their audiences. They write to increase their audiences. They write to reach out to newer and newer audiences, and which is perfectly fine, and that's how it should be. You switched genres after several banking books. Tuhin, you have been experimenting with different kinds of writing right from the beginning. You wrote a cricket thriller, you wrote a political thriller, and of course romance weaves its way all through, and now you've come out with Let the Reason Be Love, which is through and through a romantic book. So why have you not chosen a particular line of work for yourself and just stuck to that from the very beginning?
You know, my first book came out in September 2006. That was the time when the publishing industry hadn't really opened up. Ravi, your first book was
2007.
So, you know, unlike today, where you have probably 10 books coming out every month, you had 10 to 12 known books, known popular fiction books every year. And my first book happened after a reasonable amount of struggle. So it was difficult for me to, it took me some time to, took me some time to convince myself that I'm an author. And I decided to be a little harsh on myself. I decided instead of repeating the same genre, for the first 5 books, I would try to experiment as much as I can and make all the 5 books very different. Now, when I look back, probably, in terms of popularity, in terms of purely financial consideration, I think that could have been a mistake. But I think that's made the journey that much more fascinating, and that explains the reason why I've experimented with each of my books.
You know, one thing I've noticed is that the guys, at least the Indian authors, have been a bit scared about bringing in you know, risky elements into their books, somewhat. Somewhat. We are not talking Dojoy Datta right now. But with your recent book, of course, you've gone like all out, and the book begins with quite a bang to him. Ravi has been a bit kind of wary, but with the bestseller she wrote, he too has given in. But here is a lady, Madhuri Banerjee, who right from the beginning has never seen any reason not to just give in and write risky stuff. Her first book, How I Lost My Virginity and Other Stories, Other Dumb Stories, and all the rest of her other books, I mean, they are hot pot broilers. They are the kind of books that, how has it been, how has the journey been for you as a woman writing in India and, you know, just going all out?
You know, in India, women are always labeled. They are defined and they'll be put into boxes. So if you're writing in a particular format, you will be defined as an erotic writer, a thriller writer, you know. If you are in Bollywood, you will be defined as the good girl, the bad girl, the power girl. Women are, no, with men, it's far more fluid because you are allowed to experiment. I am always asked, what genre do you write in? Are you an erotic writer? And I say, I write less erotica than these people. I write less. I have never spoken about any anatomy parts in my books at all. You know, I just have like a build up and the lighting is really good and then I move on to the relationship angle. So I'm like, can there be a genre called relationships? Because that's what I write about, whether it's, you know, a clingy girlfriend, whether it's scandalous housewives, whether it's about, you know, married women, whether it's how to lose my virginity and other dumb ideas, and that's about like an unmarried woman. So it's all about relationships and what like people are going through. The erotic part is like just happens to be there because we are all human beings and it naturally comes about when you have any form of desire. So which is absolutely normal. I mean, we live in the land of Kama Sutra. So if we don't write about something which is so natural and normal for every human being, then it just feels very awkward. It's like I'm writing about like a movie in the 80s where there were two flowers and then they went away. I can't do that. So it's not risque. The joy is risque. But he's not labeled. He's labeled as a romantic writer. He's written a romantic book. He's written something which is all out romance. But I'm the erotic writer.
Blame the title of your books, my dear. Our Forbidden Desires. That's the one that's just come out, right?
Yeah, my current book is Forbidden Desires and I've had virginity and stuff on it. But it's always to break the mold of just being a chick lit writer. I've never wanted just to be the next Shobha Day. I wanted to be the first Madhuri Banerjee. We're writing about the modern woman. And the modern woman has issues.
Bravo.
So if I wrote something like, you know, oh, I love you too, or something which was as innocuous as that, nobody's going to buy my books. As it is, nobody buys my books. But
that's not true.
But yeah, so the five people who do, I mean, at least they'll say, hey, this is a risky title, let's see it. And then, you know, they'll probably put a brown paper cover on it and then take it somewhere. Or they'll buy it on Kindle because God forbid they read any of my books at home.
So, we have, you know, Write India has already been through, say, about, we've been through some of the writers, like we've had a month for Chetan Bhagat, Amish Tripathi, Ashwin Sanghi, Ravi Subramanyam, Tuhin Sinha, Preeti Shenoy, and now we are on to Ravinder Singh for January. But there was a reason why Dojoy Datta was kept for February. Guess why? Yes. Valentine's Day, and February is all about love and romance. And we saved Dojoy Datta's month for the month of February, which is when he begins. Dojoy, why are the girls so crazy about you? Are the guys also, how do the guys respond to your books?
I think when I wrote my first book, I wasn't really that girl's cute. I was very guy's cute because my first book, I did not think it'll get published. Now, because I was forced into that, so I'll tell you what happened. So first book was about this a guy who could just think about getting laid. So that was all the first book was about. And because I didn't think it would get published, that's why it was you know, all out there. There's this guy who just objectifies every girl that he sees, and he goes through all these machinations to get that girl. And a lot of guys were my fans because they all fantasized about that thing. But somewhere down the line, all these guys, started saying sweet things to the girls. And that's when the girls started liking my books. And I was under the pressure to be a romance writer because, you tell me that, Penguin tells me that I'm a romance writer, whereas I don't think that I'm a romance writer because all my love stories are totally screwed up. Like, everybody's cheating on everybody else and, you break up, you come back. There was no eternal love story for the first five books. I mean, my first couple took five books to finally reconcile and say that, okay, we are going to be with each other. Like, till the five books, they were going out with all the wrong people, doing all the wrong things and experimenting with a lot of things. And it wasn't until the sixth book that they finally said that if it's not forever, it's love. And I was forced into that because, they were like, a lot of girls are reading your books and they want an eternal love story. Please write an eternal love story. Please stop making your guys cheat. So like, fine, I'll do that. So finally I got into that mold and I was put into this romance writer wala field. In fact, I'll tell you, I wrote a book which is called Till the Last Breath, which I think is one of my better books. I've written some really shitty books in the middle because I was in college and I needed pocket money. So I wrote a few books because of that. That's okay. So what I did was, people started telling me that the only reasons why your books work is because they have a title and a subtitle, because they have the same characters that were there in the first book, because there are a few intimate scenes in the books, and because it's always set in college. So I said, okay, fine, I'll write a book that absolutely contradicts every one of those points. So I wrote a book Till the Last Breath thinking that I'm not going to set it in college, it's not going to have a subtitle and a title, it's not going to have a single intimate scene. There's just one kiss in the entire book and I had to keep it because it was looking too unnatural. Two consulting adults in a relationship and they're not doing anything other, like, what, are they asexual? So finally I had to put that in. So I wrote Till the Last Breath, which was not about all of that. It was not supposed to be a love story, but the people who read it still found a love story out of it. But I've been slotted as a romance writer, and I don't mind as long as people just go to the bookstore and buy my books. So a lot of my books aren't love stories, but there are certain pages where a love story is on a high, and people think that okay, this is a love story. So that's why I think February is my month. But would you also my birthday?
Yes. And what else?
That's it.
Okay. All right. He doesn't want to say more than that. But would you be scared of writing any other genre?
So I'm already trying to write a thriller. So my next book is thriller because I got really pissed off.
There's no romance in it.
There is romance in it, but I got really pissed off when Ravi was trying to encroach into my territory. And
that's what Ravindra said too.
Yeah, so he's writing a romance, so why not?
I'm just hoping that if Duja writes a thriller, okay, all his fans read the book, okay, and eventually they start liking thrillers. And then start reading my book.
So let me come to a few quick facts which I promised you, the stats regarding writing. There we'll get many, many more as we go along. We are right now in the middle of reading Tuhin's stories, so we don't have stats related to him. Madhuri and Durjoy are yet to take over as authors of the month. How many participants are here, are writing their participants, those who participated in it? Wow, that's a good number. That's a wonderful number. And now we have some winners here as well. We were expecting some winners. Would you please put up your hands? Wow. Congratulations, all of you. And we have your names here, I think, unless there's somebody here who we don't know is expected today. I would like to hear from all of you, actually. We would like a few, maybe or each one of them to say a few words, maybe later if we have the time. But, okay, coming back to the stats. In 6 months, like I said, we have about 18,000 plus stories. Most number of people aged above 79 years wrote for
Amish Tripathi. About 79 years, wrote for Amish Tripathi. And there were many, yes, there were quite a few. 1500 plus people between the age groups of 15 to 25 wrote for Chetan Bhagat. Most number of engineers and doctors, it seems, are interested in writing thrillers, because the maximum number of entries from engineers and doctors came for Ashwin Sanghi's prompt. I've already told you that males writing on infidelity went for Ravi Subramanian. Delhiites mostly wrote for maximum number of entries was from Delhiites. Ravi's entries were from Delhiites. Also, maximum number of homemakers wrote for Ravi Subramanian. Okay, yes, we have a Tuhin Sinha pact here. For Tuhin Sinha, we had 52 entries between the age group of 10 to 15. 52 entries of the age group 10 to 15. Of which 49 were women and only 3 men. Now, what does that prove? 49 were women and the rest men. Yeah, 10 to 15 age group, yes. What does that make Tuhin Sinha? You won't get into that. So, what for? They wrote, they just wrote. So, till now, out of the top 10, four author results, we haven't calculated the fifth one in this. Till now, out of the top 10 for the four author results, yes, the fifth, we had 24 women winners and 16 men. So we had more women. And Kolkata remains consistent in giving winners in the top 10 each time. Every time we've had winners from Kolkata. Yes, well, we have yet to see what happens in the month of Jan and Feb. The Bong ladies are going to go crazy. So city-wise from the top 10, we have Mumbai, this is for the winners. We have 9 winners from Mumbai. We have, this is calculated for the first 4 authors really, not for the fifth one. We have 7 winners from Delhi, we have 4 from Kolkata, Bangalore 3, Pune 1, so on. Then let's see, 1, 1, 1, 1 rest. Bombay is the highest for winners, yes. Kolkata is the highest for entries, but Mumbai is the highest for winners. Profession-wise, they range from doctors to IT professionals to entrepreneurs to lawyers, cabin crew, and students. Age-wise, our winners range from 14 years to 58 years. Winners. A 14-year-old won for Ravi Subramanian. And it was a beautiful story. She was supposed to be here today, Prapti, but then she told us she'll be missing school, and I told her not to miss school. So I think she didn't come. Because she's in Pune, not Mumbai. So, yes. Prapti Tanda. There are 2 names who have won twice. In fact, there are 1 or 2 more names now in the fifth. I'm sorry, the fifth has not been calculated, is it? Tishampati Sen, he was Chetan's 3rd winner and Ravi's 1st winner. Tishampati Sen, and Ashish Jindal, who's one of the top winners, 10 winners for Ashwin as well as for Ravi. Now with the new lot, we have 1 more woman who's made it a 2nd time. I'm not recalling her name right now. I'm sorry, I don't have it here. Now this, look at this, of the top 3 winners, each time, Chetan's contest is the only one which had only male all 3 winners, top 3 winners. The rest, all 5 of them, have had 2 women and 1 man each time out of the top 3. 2 women, 1 man every time. So these are where stats are concerned. I would really like it to be more, like we all would, where we discuss this, like it to be more a session of you people asking questions and the authors here answering you. So can we just get on with a round of questions and answers before calling the winners on stage?
Anyone with questions, if you could just raise your hands, I'll pass the mic one by one.
Hi, this is for Mr. Subramanian. You said that you changed the genre. I wanted to know how much research goes into it as a writer. When you're writing a different genre which you're not comfortable with, maybe, is there any research that goes in, or you just follow your heart?
Well, the way I did was I followed my heart. And my earlier genre required a fair bit of research because of the intricate subject matter involved. But writing about romance, I think it's more from within, right? You just don't need to do research. You don't want to do some research, pick up the books written by Tuhin, Madhuri, Dujai, Ravindar, and all those people, and then read. And then that gives you an indication of the style they follow to talk about romance, to talk about characters, to talk about relationships. I think that's the best you can do in terms of research. But the amount of research they do would actually depend on the kind of genre that you're writing. If you want to write a thriller and you're not, for example, when I was writing a thriller and I wanted to put a car chase sequence in it, I tried writing, I couldn't. I read a lot of books to figure out if a car chase figures in any of those books. I couldn't really figure out how to write a car chase sequence. I was so frustrated that eventually I dropped the car chase sequence from my book and moved on. Okay. So your research would, you know, to cut a long story short, it would entirely depend on the genre that you're writing in,
yeah,
and your expertise in that particular genre or what you know about that particular genre.
Thank you.
Hello, good evening everyone. My name is and I'm a writer by passion. So I just want to ask everyone, like, you know, there's a lot of struggle. So how do you cope with it? Like, I have just left my teaching profession for this. So I would just like to know that. Like, I'm very confused between genres, different stories. So how do you get down to that?
I think the struggle has not yet started for you.
Okay.
It's yet to come. And I'm not meaning that by in terms of wanting to get you dejected.
Okay.
But it's better to have a realistic view in terms of where you're going. When I started writing my first book, that was around 2004 or 5. It took me another 2 years by the time I was done with researching and actually writing it. And I thought that at the time when I completed my manuscript, I was elated because someone who hadn't written anything longer than a couple of pages had suddenly written a manuscript which was running into some 90, 95,000 words. So I was excited as hell. But I was to still realize that that was the starting point of my journey. Because once I had the manuscript, then we went into the next stage, which was trying to find either a literary agent or trying to find a publisher. And throughout from 2007 all the way through till 2009, actually that entire period of 18 or 20 odd months, I ended up writing to hundreds, and most of them would not even reply. The few that did would basically send a very kind and sort of very courteous reply saying, thank you, but no thank you. You're not really right for us. I joke amongst our friends that probably I hold the world rejection record because I added it up, it was about 47. So that is a process which you will end up going through. But having said that, I think if you are very serious about what you are doing, then you figure out ways to motivate yourself to remain at it. I have strongly always believed that the best-selling writers of our times are not the best writers. They are simply the most obstinate writers. You know, the ones who simply just want to make something happen. So for example, in my case, when I was getting rejected left, right and center, I had a big board in front of my desk which said J.K. Rowling 12, Stephen King 30, and Chicken Soup for the Soul 36. Those were basically the number of rejections that they had. And I figured that, well, I'm doing much better than Stephen King and I'm doing much better than J.K. Rowling. So I'm doing something right. You have to find ways to motivate yourself. As regards the choice of genre and as regards in terms of what you write, the first step is to actually sit down and start writing. There were at least 2-3 people before this event who came and spoke to me and said, I'm confused about what to write. I said, don't be confused, start writing. Once you get the first 20, 30, 50 pages done, you'll know when you'll step back that which is the area that excites you. There is an old theory which says that the job of a writer is to make familiar things sound new and to make new things sound familiar. So you can start either way.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much.
Hello, I'm Nilesh Chogle, and I am also a debutant writer, and I have published the first novel of mine, Together With You Forever. It has been published by Notion Press. I had to go to Notion Press because as Mr. Sanghi said, there are rejections which do come from published, established, publishers. So this was my experiment and I wanted to definitely write. Now my question to Write India is, first of all, I'm not very clear as to, you know, what is expected, really speaking, from Write India to, you know, get selected, because there are a couple of writers here who have already got selected, and obviously their writing would be better than what I have contributed or some others have contributed. So that area I would like to get it cleared. And secondly, those who have not got cleared or selected in the first 10 or so, what would be the plight of those who have contributed and haven't taken the step of writing the, you know, using your creativity and writing? These are my two questions. Thank you.
So, first of all, as I keep repeating again and again to people who say, oh, I lost this time, I keep saying it and I'm going to repeat it even many, many more times. There are no losers in Write India. I am very definite about that. Because you can only participate in Write India after you have written a story. And anybody who has already completed a story cannot be a loser. So you sent in that story. Now, out of the thousands of entries, there can only be a few winners. You know, we can announce only a few winners, let's say. Now, if I announce 10 names, it does not mean that the 11th is any worse than the 10th. But there could be some reason, you know, that the 10th was selected in the top 10 and the 11th not. It doesn't mean that the 21st or the 30th is far worse than the 10th. It could be just a slight difference, a little bit of a difference, but those differences are there, and then, you know, again, they could vary, they're subjective also. You know, however much careful you may be, and we were really hit by the numbers that came to us. Honestly speaking, we were not prepared. We were not prepared when we started off with Amish Tripathi, and there used to be days when I used to think, oh God, even if I get 4 or 5 stories, at least it'll save my face. I'll be able to announce that, okay, winner number 1, 2, 3. And there would be other days when I would think, oh, what will happen if I get too many stories and we can't deal with it. But I obviously didn't prepare for the second. I only prepared for the first, thinking 4-5 to aa jaye at least, you know. So, but when we started getting in thousands for 1 week, I didn't know what to do. I froze. And we didn't have a proper team at that time. It was just my editorial team at the Times of India. So we just sat and we huddled together and thought, what should we do? And after that, we, you know, worked out a system. And we decided that what I'm very particular about is that not a single good story should slip through. You can bring up a bad story and show it to me in the top 70, 80 stories that come to me finally, but not a single good story should slip through that. So we worked out a system, a very rigorous system where, you know, there is a level 1 of reading, there's a level 2 of reading, and then there's a level 3, and then the 70, 80 stories come to me and the author decides however many he or she wants to read. So we are very, very careful about that. Now we worked out, now how do we look at the stories? Because everybody has to be on the same page as for the criteria.
Yeah.
I have a criteria for judgment, and I must say Ashwin helped me build that up again. Also the other authors, I've put in those points as well, because all through we have been talking to each other, the authors have been hands-on totally, and the kind of passionate involvement I've got from them all through is amazing, really amazing. You wouldn't imagine that these guys would take out the kind of time they have taken out and participate in the judgment process and in the chats that we have, the Twitter chats, and all through, you know, and I've been calling up each one of them and asking for advice, and we've been discussing things, so that it's never been just me or my team. It's always been the authors who are with us. So as we went along, every month we would ask the author, what is the criteria, what's the story you're looking for? We built on that, and then when Ashwin's month came, he actually put down all those thoughts very well. So That is what I've put down and added all the other stuff we had. So, and this is the actually the criteria of judgment. We look at it, it was figured out if the start of the story is catchy enough to hook the reader. You know, does it hook me? Or does it bore me and I don't even want to read on? But my, of course, my rule is that you still have to read till the end. Was the story compelling? Did it make you want to turn the page? Did you want to even turn the page and read the next page what's happening? Or did it compel you to read further? Was the language and grammar clean? Just clean, okay? We are not talking about great language here. We are not even looking for people who are writing beautifully. We are looking for good stories, engaging matter, and for basic clean grammar. Was the end kind of something that led from the beginning and it was like, you know, something that satisfied you at the end and not something that just, you know, leaves you in the lurch and there's no connection from the beginning to the end? Was, sometimes, you know, a twist in the tale helps. It shocks you and if dealt with well. I hesitate to say this because I noticed that some stories we've selected where there's been a twist in the tale, when that word gets out, everybody's starting to give a twist in the tale now and it doesn't really work for everyone. It really doesn't. It's like sometimes it totally falls flat on its face. So you have to write what you really, what comes from within. You have to say what you want to say. It can't be saying something else somebody else wants to say. You can't be passing on someone else's message. Was the narration easy to understand? There are some people whose stories are so convoluted and complicated that when you're halfway through, you have to think and then go back and say, oh, where did this come from? Let me go back and figure out what happened really. So it should be like an easy flow, something easy to understand. And are there any logical errors, you know, in the story? Did the story idea wow you? Like, you know, at the end of the test that I personally use always is, when I read a story, I walk away from it for a while. When I read 2-3 stories, I walk away from them. The story that sticks to my mind is the one, you know, it'll keep coming back again and again. So it just does, it refuses to go out of your mind. So that's the test that I normally use. So that's about it. And now you, the second question that you asked is what will happen to the rest of the writers, the ones who are not in the top 10. I am, you know, talking to all our authors, all through, we are all discussing it. What do? Because we have beautiful stories and people who put their heart, mind and soul into these stories. We are thinking of having workshops. We've been talking to our team at the Times of India. Some of them are here and, you know, some of the guys from our sales department are here. I can't see them right now, but they are here and they have been very, very helpful. So we need that help. We need some help from outside to start these workshops for writers, which we will take across the country and invite Write India participants to these workshops so that we can go through individual stories and be able to tell them. I have yet to request our authors to be part of it. I just know that they will not say no. Once we are able to work out a structure, we will do something. And there will be many more books, not just, we promised only the first winner of every author they will publish their story as a book, but we will have many more books than that.
That's very nice. Very well answered, Vinita. One more question I want to ask, this is to Ravi. Ravi's video I have seen speaking to Trishan Bhatti, and at the end Ravi has mentioned, you know, that you should close up all the loose ends in your story. Can you just enlighten on that? I have not understood that part, please.
Okay, I'm glad you saw that video. I said that you need to close up all the loose ends because typically when you read a story and there are bits and pieces of the story which you don't understand or can't relate to or something which is just hanging, okay, and kind of leaves a bit of a sour taste in your mouth. I think that kind of diminishes the impact a story will have on you. I think that's what I meant when I said he needs to tie in all the loose ends, which is there should be no part of the story which seems out of place, which is probably left in midway just to take the story forward. Because then you would feel that those elements have been introduced just for effect, just to, you know, just for shock value or whatever. So you need to make sure that if you take the story in a particular direction, seamlessly take it in that direction. If you introduce twists in it, make sure the twists are properly covered in the end. Otherwise, it leaves a bad taste. So that's what I meant.
I have a question for Madhuri. My name is Mukta Mahajani. I'm a published author with Jerko Publishing House. They have two books of mine on negotiation and communication at the workplace, and I'm a lawyer also by profession. I also advise on negotiation and mentoring for young adults. So you spoke about how we get cat. Thank you. It's hard. You spoke about being categorized as a woman, and one of the other things I also face is that you need support from your family, from your community, from your friends, your relations, and you have to keep your chin up all the time because you are I'm a lawyer, I'm an advocate, I'm a negotiator, I'm a writer, I'm a family person, a sister, a daughter, so many things, you know. So I want to ask you, do you have any special tips for women authors or aspiring women authors? Because many times you're in the middle of a manuscript and you want to write and you can't write because you have so many other things you have to do, or you lose track, or some life happens. So any special tips? Even I would like to know, what can I learn when I get busy and I have to stay on track with my book? Thank you.
What? You don't agree?
Okay. No, I'd love to know why you don't agree. Please.
No, you know what? I just feel that you play so many roles all the time. You're a wife or a girlfriend or a mother, yes, or whatever, you know, a daughter, and you have to like play these roles as well as you're working and stuff like that. I just feel that we are constantly looking for appreciation for our work. We are constantly looking for, like, why aren't you grateful? Why isn't it, you know, why isn't this happening? Why aren't my books selling? Why am I not getting a publisher? Why is my story not getting, like, first prize? I think at some level, you know, you have to write because you truly want to. It's like, you know, when you, it has to come from your heart. It's like every bloody blood, sweat and tear, and that's what you're going to put on the paper. After that, it's that story's destiny of what you want to do. So, you know, when people are saying, why aren't you doing this and why aren't you doing that, you write because you feel like writing, you know, which is what the AV talks about, you know, what Write India actually is. So, so my main tip for all women writers is don't box yourself in. Don't think, oh my God, if I write this, what will my parents think? You're not writing for your parents. Don't say, oh my God, if I don't finish this work, I will not have enough time to write. Or say, if I write this, I will not be able to do that. You know, don't box yourself in. Give yourself some leeway to do what you want to do. If you don't feel like writing today, chuck it. Don't write. You know, it's not like a do it every single day. I mean, you have so many responsibilities in any case. Give yourself a break and write when you truly feel like it and you're inspired, and you'll write beautifully.
Thank you. Thank you.
But
agreed. I would love to know.
Yes, Ravi and Tuhin, for instance, two authors. Okay. I know, for instance, that you know they are hands-on dads.
Yes. Okay.
They spend as much time with their children. Yes. Yes. No. No. I'm not saying anything against them. I'm just trying to say that if women have it difficult, it's difficult for men too, and they are handling two careers.
Correct.
You know, they are not just writing. They're not just writers.
Sure.
Ashwin as well. He handles a full, very successful business.
Okay.
And as a writer on top of it. So men have it just as difficult as women do.
Sure, ma'am.
Okay. I would just say, if you want to write, get out of the ghayal mode. Okay?
Right.
Saying, oh my God, the world is falling on my head. We have 20 things to do.
Okay.
If you have 20 things to do, because of which you are not able to write, which means you are not prioritizing writing over those 20 other things.
Okay.
I have a day job. I have a daughter who I tend to.
Yeah.
I have a lot of other things which I do in life apart from writing. But I still write and bring out a book a year. Okay, so I think it's all about prioritizing your every single day. For every single human being, it has 24 hours.
No.
You need the 25th hour to write your book. That 25th hour has to come from your 24 hours. Stop watching TV.
Right,
I don't watch TV. Stop socializing. I don't go for parties.
Okay.
So you have to write, you have to prioritize writing over everything else. Otherwise, you're not doing justice to it.
Thank you.
The only thing I can tell you is that if you wait for the right time to write, that you will never be able to write. So, just write.
Good evening. I am Dilip Kakran, an accountant by training. It's a truism to state that writing reflects human experience, which is a fallout of human nature. So, in the process of writing, does it also reach out your own lives, personal or professional? Please. This we will address to all the writers on the stage. Thank you.
Let us reflect the person. We start with Durjoy and then maybe somebody else can pick it up.
So I'll talk about myself. I can't talk about other people because he has been writing banking thrillers. So obviously, he hasn't run those many frauds. So when I started writing, and I got published when I was a fetus. So I got published when I was 21, and I hadn't, when I was like really little, like. So I got published really, really early, and I hadn't read a lot of things. I hadn't watched a lot of movies and stuff like that. So the only place that I could draw inspiration from was real life. And that's why I wrote about relationships and, you know, the kind of friends that I had, the kind of relationships that I had with my parents. So I only knew them. That's why everything in my, at least my first 3 or 4 books drew heavily from all of that. And it's, and you know, when you're starting to write, it's almost a natural progression into writing things that you're closely associated with. So that's why I wrote the things that I wrote. And it's very easy, and you know that, you know, it's familiar ground, it's your comfort zone. You know, okay, so my friend who's about this age, and this guy that who I know, he's going to behave in a certain way in a certain situation. That's why it came all very easy to me, but slowly and steadily. That's why they say whenever you write your second book, that's your hardest. And that's why my second book is my worst book, because you know, I had put all my experiences in my first book, and the second book I was like on shaky ground. I had to like, so first book was in college, which I was in. Second book, I was still in college, but I was writing about a life in an investment bank. So everything was make-believe. Like it was like setting a book in Hogwarts. I absolutely had no idea what I was writing about. But I still wrote that book because I like to write. But yeah, you have to draw from real life experiences if you are starting out, and it definitely becomes a lot easier.
So. Okay, thank you. What about other writers?
Sorry. Mr. Ravi, I was deeply disappointed when you said that your earlier genre did not have character development, because Bangster, I love the character Karan Punjabi and the other, even the guy in Kerala coastal, in Malabar area actually. So what kind of character development, means enhanced character development is going in your current books and all that? And I would also like to know about character development from Tuhin Sinha also. Like what kind of research goes in building a character?
I'm glad you pointed.
For me, it's important that each character comes a full circle, because that's how we all evolve in life. What you must have been 10 years ago, I'm not sure whether you're the same person or what, or whether you would be the same person 10 years hence. So I think that's something which I keep in mind. Through the journey of the story, each character more or less comes a full circle. Apart from that, I think in the first few books, I have drawn heavily from, you know, personal experiences or the experiences of my friends or people who I see around me. But then the idea was to weave fact with fiction in a way that it leaves the readers guessing all the time. Now, of course, after 7 books, I've reached a stage where I've exhausted my personal experiences. So I write and then try to experience it. So that's about character development.
Ravi, before you take this question, interestingly, Tuhin's books, he writes a lot from the female viewpoint. So does Durjoy. This is something that, you know, really surprises me no end. How do they get it so right? I mean, the way a woman thinks, the way a woman is. What kind of research do you do for that?
Well, like I said, you know, with every The Edge of Desire was my fourth book, and it was written in first person in the voice of a woman protagonist. So the basic idea was drawn from Mahabharata, where and it posed a question to the readers: can the humiliation of a woman alter the destiny of a nation? It happened with Draupadi, and it happened with my protagonist. So rapes and crimes against women is always something which would disturb anybody when you read about them in the morning papers.
the idea was to create a story which had a parallel with Mahabharata. So obviously, I mean, the research that went into it was to kind of try and figure out how a woman would feel, you know, and the woman protagonist who was raped in my book was the wife of an IAS officer, which was loosely inspired from a real story which has happened in North Bihar in, and in Orissa in the late 1990s. So it was more about the angst, and it was more about, you know, all that she would go through post that. I think it's more about just
getting about the bush and not really coming to the point. I asked her, how do you know how a woman feels exactly? It was a compliment, really. I mean, because the books, also Durja is the one I've been reading. I mean, it's amazing.
I think it's just instinctive for me. I'm born on International Women's Day, so that explains, you know, I understand women better.
What about you? Okay, Ravi, you would like to answer?
I'm glad you pointed out that Karan Punjabi character in Bankster is a very well-developed character. There's a reason to it. Karan Punjabi comes across two different books. You know, so you have that much more time and space to devote to develop that particular character. When you're writing a standalone story, which is a thriller, it's often a fine balance between characterization and plot. So, and somewhere in my thrillers, the plot takes precedence. There are people who write thrillers where characters also develop, and often they write a series. For example, Jack Reacher, you can't find a better developed character in a thriller. So it all boils down to the individual choice of an author, individual writing style of an author. My writing style in my thrillers was largely plot driven. I used to have 15 characters in my book, okay, and people have often complained that there are too many characters, and often you have to go back and refer to, you know, which character was what, because he keeps coming in and going out of the book. The new book bestseller she wrote has 5 characters. Now you write 400 pages based on 5 characters, you have the entire universe to develop the particular individual. And that's what I've done in the new book. So that's what I meant when I said that writing about relationships, it's more character driven than a plot driven book.
So maybe we can have 2 more questions, please.
Okay, hi. Vinita, my question is for you, actually. I think through this initiative, you have touched in all these storytellers in India. Okay, but there are many few like you, you know, who write so wonderfully well, you know, the Ozone column in Times of India. So somebody who's aspiring and trying to be doing something in terms of being a columnist, does Times of India want to touch up even those who are around in India and who want to do that, which is not exactly storytelling as this initiative is?
You mean non-fiction?
That's right, yeah.
Writing. And now once we've been hit by the success of Write India, there are a lot of thoughts we are all discussing, talking about. Poetry is something that many people have approached us for. Regional languages, Write India and regional languages is another thought. We are discussing all this at office, and let's see what we come up with.
Good evening, dignitaries. First of all, I feel so proud that till 1 hour ago, I was very much disappointed with my write-ups, with my scripts, which I presented to Write India with so much of genuine conviction, honesty, storytelling skills, as Angi Saab said. At the same time now, in this hour, and honestly, I was full of negativity and what to do, after doing so much, but after hearing Sandi Saab, Subramanian Saab, and I have read your book, If God Was the Banker, which I like the most, Krishna Ki. So I thought, why not to write something out of the box, whether they like my creativity, whether that tradition which I bear, and am I connecting with the modern trend? Or have I become so old that only youngsters are getting it? And there is no place for me. But then I am very much thankful to you. You are real gurus for me. I am very much thankful.
I think we couldn't have ended on a more better note. I'll request all those with questions. We're going to have more of meeting and greeting post the event when the authors would like to sign their books. So what we're going to do now is Ravi has something to say before we move on, and we have the winners to be announced as well. So I'd like Ravi to tell us. I think he has a question.
Okay, I have a question for Vinita.
We went end with Vinita in the hot seat.
Absolutely. She's asked all of us questions all these days, right? So now let's ask her a question. Should we?
Yes. Yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, you have 11 authors in Write India, right? So how many done? Six done, right? Five done, six done, yeah? So five more to go. Six, yeah. So, which means another 5 months, Write India will be over. So what next? It's a brilliant franchise that you've created. It's a fabulous movement that you've actually created. 18,000 stories till now, which is like the entire wall of Crossword. That entire wall will not even have 1,800 books which contain 18,000 stories. I was just counting. So it's those many stories and those many books you've created. Now, don't give it up. So what next?
Thank God he didn't ask anything tougher. Ravi, as you know, and I keep discussing it with you a lot, that what next are we going to do? And as I just said, I would like Write India to continue. I'd like it to, like, you know, go into a season 2, a season 3, a season 4, which is what we keep discussing at office also. I keep insisting, I've been pushing it for this reason, that we should not, at the end of Write India, say, oh, great, a great success story, and that's it. We should be in this business for a very, very long time to come. And what has really encouraged me is truly, and I say it again, the response of all the authors who are part of Write India. They are all, I feel it's because they, most of them are people who did not always want to be writers. They became writers. So they are very willing and happy to help other people. And with that kind of encouragement, I think we should definitely be looking at what I want to do is maybe Write India in Hindi, maybe other regional languages. Definitely continue English. I'm not too sure about whether we'll go into poetry and non-fiction and stuff really, but certainly I would like it to continue for a long, long time.
Thank you so much, Vinita, and we wish Write India and the entire team all the very best for that.
Thank you.
We now move on to the winners. We have a couple of them here with us. If you could just tell us a little more about it.
We have actually seven of them here with us, yes. And I mean, it makes me very happy that there are so many participants from Write India. I hope you will continue writing. When I thought in between that there were people who were getting a little disillusioned because they were not, their names were not in the top 10, that's when we announced that all participants who have written for every author, for all 11 authors, there's a surprise in store for them. And we stand by that. So please continue writing whether you're there in the top 10 or not. And now we have here, first let's call here Amita Anand. Amita Anand, are you here? I'm calling you because you are the second prize winner for Ashwin Sanghi's passage. And I would like Ashwin to... You want to say a few words?
You know, like I mentioned to you, first of all, thank you so much for personally answering every tweet that I sent out, because it means so much, you know, because like what you said, that you have to face rejection. But for me, I think it started with myself. The first thing I had to overcome was self-rejection, because you read all these wonderful authors and then you read your own writing and you always compare. And I had never gone beyond Facebook and putting up a page, and your friends and family always say, oh, that was amazing. But to be judged by someone like you all who are professional writers and publishers, it meant so much. It was so sweet of you to answer every query, and I actually had to get on Twitter just for that. I haven't actually written for any except for Ashwin sir, but today I'm inspired again, especially by... No, actually I'm a young mother as well, a mother of a young child rather, so... Now today I was inspired by her as well, and I'm definitely going to write for the next, but I don't know if I can compete with all the bong ladies for February, so, and thank you so much, it really means a lot.
We have Rashmi Pillai here. So Rashmi Pillai is one of the top 10 contestants for Ravi Subramanian's passage, so Ravi.
Yeah, hello. I am basically from the scientific community, and It's something, I work for the pharmaceutical industry, and writing is not something which I do on a very regular basis. This initiative has helped me to, it's something like a hobby which I follow, and I write to, it's like a stress buster for me most of the time. So I think I've started to take it more seriously because of this initiative. It has given me a kind of focus. Month after month, I look for the passage which comes. I've been writing for most of the authors. I just missed the first one, I think. Every month, I take it that, you know, even like the other authors have also mentioned, even with a demanding job or anything else which you are pursuing, any other career, if you really want to do it, if you really want to write, I really take back that message that I need to focus more on it, and I hope I will, and I do continue to write.
We have two first prize winners here with us today. Nayanesh Jadwani, who was the first prize winner for Chetan Bhagat's passage. Congratulations, Nayanesh. He's already met, you want me to do that? He's already met Chetan, and he's got his Kindle already.
When I heard about this competition, I just had one aim, actually, that I should have 10 stories under my belt. I heard about it after Amish's competition was done. So I just came in with that. I just thought I should have 10 stories under my belt. Before this, I had just written two short stories in college, and I was like, if I get that much, that's good enough for me. But winning this was like a huge bonus, and I think I won because this particular story, I wrote it very passionately. I had just recently read a book by Ramchandra Guha, and there was a part in it about the Godhra thing, and I was really, it really impacted me. And then the Chetan Bhagat's passage came, and I was able to put both of these things into it, and I just wrote very passionately. I have written for all the other authors, and I have not won anything yet. Probably because there was not enough passion, but I'll keep trying.
And the one who has just been announced, I haven't even seen her, Sama. She is the winner for Preeti Shenoy, which we just announced the result on the 15th of January. And Madhuri, would you do the honors for her?
Firstly, I'm really grateful to all of y'all for this initiative. It really helps upcoming writers. And the only thing I wanted out of this journey, out of the 11 months, was that bas ek baar main top 10 mein aa jaun, bas, by God, just once. I want that one push. Yes, and the funny thing is, when you write, so I want to become a writer professionally and not just as a hobby. I'm writing. And I just see you give your manuscript and everything you write to your mom and your father. They're not going to tell you it's crap. They're going to tell you you're awesome and you're amazing and all those beautiful things. But you want that one push from somebody you don't know, from somebody, you know, who's not related to you, to tell you that, you know, you're good. And when that push comes from such renowned personality, such well-known, the best in the industry, it really pushes you, and that confidence, all the rejections, and by the way, I'm competing with you on the rejections. All the rejections, they just go down the drain, and you're like, you know, that one person makes you feel that the rejections don't matter. As long as one person told you that you're good, and it's not your mother, because your mother will always tell you you're good, it works. And honestly, when I came to know the top 10, I was telling a friend, bus top 10 has come, it's okay. I don't want to know, don't rain on my parade, I don't want to know who the winner is. Just let it go. Then I said, third, oh, it's not me. I said, third to aa sakti thi. chalo gaya. Then I said, who's the second one? I was like, oh, I didn't even come second. I don't want to know. And when I saw I was the first person, I was like, wow, this is a different feeling altogether. So thank you. Thank you so much for this initiative. Thank you. You're an angel for all of us, all as aspiring writers. Thank you.
And if the rest of you need that push which she got, I want to tell all of you that all of you who participated and who intend to participate are brilliant already. All of you are wonderful. So, I was kind of waiting for Amish with one eye on the door, but it doesn't look like he's able to make it. So, Manisha Ail, who won the second prize for Amish Tripathi. Manisha, Kahin, would you do the honors for Manisha?
Okay, Write India was the first time I wrote in 10 years. As in, previously through school and college, I used to write a lot. But then I went into medicine and completely stopped reading and writing. And this was just accidental. My sister said, see, this has come and if you want, you can write. And I read the passage and I felt like I should write this and I wrote. So thank you so much first for providing that opportunity. And I wrote and I forgot all about it. I'll be very serious. I sent it in at the last minute and then I forgot all about it. I hadn't even checked who the winners were. I was at work and I get a call on the next day saying that, oh, you are a winner. I'm like, really? So, yeah, that was like, it was a kind of an amazing vindication. Like, yeah, yes. Yeah. Actually, it's pronounced Isle. Yeah, but it is, yeah. So, yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks to everyone. Thank you for.
We have another Amish winner here, one of the top 10 contestants, top 10 winners, Juhi Kothari. Juhi, give joy.
Thank you all, first thing, and I think I've just been here and there all through my life, not knowing what to do. I just got into a field because no other college took me in, and then I switched jobs, and then finally a friend tagged me in a post of Times of India, and I read the passage. I was absolutely confused about where do I need to use the passage. I just wrote, and then it had strict rules about history and Shivaji, who I had completely forgotten about. But as I started reading about Shivaji, I realized that it's pretty fascinating to weave something which is already existing into something which is fictional. And I wrote, I forgot. So Manisha got a call on the second day. I got a call on the third day saying that, oh, you have won. And I was like, I hope you're not kidding me because I don't know, I haven't read Amisha's work at all. So I don't know what caliber. I've heard he is one of the best writers in India, but to be at that part that he has read my story, that's more than enough. And what Times of India has done for me now is that the book that I'm working on right now has a more of an element of history woven into fiction. So it has given me that impetus to pursue what I started with, and it has also given me that motivation that I have still come in the top three. And I will still continue writing. And like Sabha said, that the validation that you need from somebody who's not your family and somebody who is sitting on a panel which is a nationwide level means a lot. So thanks a lot for your time and your efforts on us. Thank you.
So after you wrote the story, did you buy all of Amish's book and read them? How unfair, no?
I'm so sorry. So I'll tell you why. No. I can tell you why. I was researching on character development and I went through what... No, for something else. How characters are... Because till then I didn't know what I wanted to write.
So if I was working maybe on a romantic novel, maybe, but so I needed to know how a character is developed. So there were these basic questions and typical things that Google crops up with, and then I found something on the internet, and then that's how.
We have Aman Mehta with us, who is one of the top 10 winners for Chetan Bhagat's passage. Aman, please come here. And I'm going to request Ashwin to. Aman seems like a young boy. Are you in school? In college.
Yeah, so I'm 18 and I'm still a student. I was still figuring out what I want to do, and when this opportunity came along and I wrote and I got recognition for it, so now I know that writing is something that I want to do and it's what I'm going to pursue wholeheartedly from now on. So thank you.
Any other winner hiding somewhere here that we don't know about? You should all have put up your hands. I told you, you're all winners. Thank you very much. Is there anything anybody else wants to say or ask? No more questions, okay. So thank you very much, and thank you, Crossword. Thank you, Right Place. They have been great partners, and there is a great opportunity for many of you at the Right Place. At the Right Place, you are in the right place right now. So thank you very much for being here with us. Thank you, my panelists. Thank you so much for sparing time. Each one of them is a very, very busy writer and busy with lots of other stuff, and they have spared this evening for us. Thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Vinita. Thank you so much to all our authors, and thank you so much to each one of you for making your presence felt here with us. We'd like to let you know that we have all of these wonderful authors' books here for those that would like to pick up their copies and have them signed by the very authors of those books. Thank you very much. Let's have a round of applause once again for all of them here. Thank you very much. You've been a wonderful audience. Thank you.